Good morning, Harvest. It's raining outside while we're recording this. Hope you're staying dry and warm somewhere. Let's start this morning in worship. Very nature, God, make nothing of yourself. Your love is amazing. Stepping into time, you took the form of man. Your love is amazing. Your love is amazing. And how great is the love of God. Your body broken on the cross. How great was the price you paid. Your love is so amazing. How great was your gift of love. My freedom bought with sinless blood. How great was my debt you paid. Your love is so amazing. Your love is so amazing to me. King of glory, come, servant of us all. Your love is amazing. Live a perfect life, died a sinner's death. Your love is amazing. Your love is amazing. How great is the love of God. Your body broken on the cross. How great was the price you paid. Your love is so amazing. How great was the gift of love. My freedom bought with sinless blood. How great was my debt you paid. Your love is so amazing. Your love is so amazing to me. My joy, you are my song, you are the well, the one I'm drawing from, you are my refuge, my whole life long, where else would I go? Be my guide, it's the strength of my soul, your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. Day after day, night after night, I will remain. All of the battle, it rages on. War is already won. I know the war is already won. Surely my God is the strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like my God is strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. Surely my God is strength of my soul. Your love defends me. Your love defends me. And when I feel like I'm all alone, your love defends me. Your love defends me. We sing hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation. Hallelujah. You're my portion, my salvation.
From the darkness called your name. Into darkness your mercy came. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love. You bore my weakness. You took my shame. Buried my burdens in fields of grace. And you called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love. From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth. Innocent perfection, gave your life for us. We are amazed, and we stand in awe. For we have been changed by the power of the cross. How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great. In your presence, where I belong. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love. From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth. Innocent perfection, gave your life for us. We are amazed, and we stand in awe. For we have been changed by the power of the cross. How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love for us.
There has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There's never been,
there will never be God like you. Love so true, there has never been, there will never be God like you. Love so true, there has never been, there will never be God like you. Love so true. Your love is great. Lord is kind, is merciful. Lord, you are, Lord, you called us to love and to love one another and call to love those who've hurt us and those who are just around us, our co-workers, our neighbors, our friends, our students, our fellow students. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would speak to your Pastor Gerald now, as he shares from Mark chapter 9. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Harvest. The scripture reading for today comes from Mark 9, 30 through 37. Hear the word of the Lord. They left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. They came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who is the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child whom he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." Thanks be to God. This morning, I want to share a message called The Wrong Direction. I wonder, what comes to your mind when you think of that phrase, the wrong direction? For me, I actually think of when I'm traveling to unfamiliar destinations and I get lost, and so I begin to panic. Am I headed in the wrong direction? What do I need to do to get back on track? How about you? What do you think of when you hear that phrase, the wrong direction? Maybe you think of certain people that you know at school or at work who are making all these foolish mistakes. They cross all these people unnecessarily, and you think to yourself, wow, you are headed in the wrong direction. You're not making your future brighter, just making things so much harder for yourself. What do most people think of when they hear that phrase, the wrong direction? For me, lately, I've been thinking of my 7-year-old son, Joshua, of course, because he likes to play this game where he wants me to guess what's in his mind. So he gives me these clues and he says, "Now it's your turn, Daddy, guess what I'm thinking." And depending on what I say, he might either respond with, "Daddy, you're getting warmer," or he'll say, "No, Daddy, you're getting colder. You're headed in the wrong direction." And generally, isn't that what most people think of when we think of that phrase, the wrong direction? We think of these poor decisions, these foolish mistakes, these unhelpful patterns of thinking that we just can't let go of, that take us in the wrong direction and away from where we really need to be. Well, why am I sharing about this with you this fine Sunday morning? It's because In the passage for this morning's message, we find Jesus seemingly headed in the wrong direction. Here at the peak of his popularity in his earthly ministry, yet determined to go to a cross and die for you and for me. But what I want to share about with you today is how in the world's eyes, it was completely the wrong direction. But for those of us who are in Christ, it's actually exactly the right direction for everything you might be going through today. And so this morning, I want to unpack that idea by sharing with you 3 points about how in the world's eyes, it may seem like the wrong direction. But for us who are in Christ, it's exactly the right direction that I need to take for everything that's going on in my life today. So let's get to it. The very first point, I call it the direction doesn't make sense. It's wrong, the world tells us. Let's see how this story begins in verses 30 to 31. It says, they, being the disciples and Jesus, they left that place and passed through Galilee. And Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. And here it is. He said to them, the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise. Seems that this is the second time Jesus has told his closest friends that he's about to die. The first was about 2 weeks ago. And you know how when you share this heavy news with people that you know love you, you know that they'll take it to heart, that they'll really understand. It's not like they'll forget. You know, they'll clearly remember because they care about you. But what's really odd here is that as Jesus shares this very heavy news that he's about to die, instead, what he's greeted with is this very awkward silence. Nobody quite knows what to say. Verse 32, it says, they did not understand what he meant and were afraid to ask him about it. And when it says they didn't understand, it doesn't mean literally. It's not like he was speaking a foreign language and they couldn't understand. The reality is they understood exactly those words that were coming out of his mouth. But the point is they just didn't. They really didn't want to hear that. Kind of like when people go to a doctor's office for a routine checkup and to their surprise, they receive instead this very bad news. They've been diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. Sometimes when people receive unexpectedly very bad news, they respond in a very surprising way. They walk out of the doctor's office and they've got a big smile on their face and they're laughing and maybe they're even telling jokes. They're singing songs and maybe whistling to themselves as if they don't have a care in the world. But it's not that they didn't understand what the doctor just told them. The reality is they just didn't want to hear it. And they weren't quite in a place where they could accept such news. Maybe as an indication of how far the disciples had pushed this idea away from them, look what happens next. Verses 33 to 34. They came to Capernaum, and when he, being Jesus, was in the house, he asked them, what were you arguing about on the road? But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who is the greatest. You see, in their mind, they just couldn't accept what Jesus said. It just didn't make any sense to them. Why, if you had worked so hard to get to this point, would anyone in their right mind throw it away? They couldn't have been what you meant. And so they begin to argue consistent with how most people in this world think. They start to argue, which one of us is the greatest? Which one of us is the most talented? I am surely the one who's most necessary for this band of brothers. Because for these 12 disciples, they, like most humans in this world, and here is a principle about life, they think that life only makes sense when things are going up and to the right. Isn't that so true that that's exactly how most people in this world think? Life only makes sense when it's up and to the right. On our performance reviews, we want to be up and to the right. With me, with my money, because I wanted to grow. I know on all my financial charts, I want it up and to the right. I want my money to grow, right? That's understandable. I don't want it to be shrinking and dwindling away. When we think about our offices, we want it higher and closer to the window. And as much of life as possible, we want it to be on that road that's up and to the right. And so Jesus, why are you intentionally going down in it? Why do you want to die like a criminal? And Jesus, sensing that his closest friends have misunderstood something fundamental about life, shares with them what life is really all about. Verse 35, sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, and here is a principle of life that I hope we don't pass by. Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all. And here Jesus is sharing with us a principle that true greatness is shown through the willingness to serve others. And of course, his disciples don't understand this. They think, how can you be first and last at the same time? Isn't that an oxymoron? Why are you talking like a Chinese fortune cookie? And they don't get what he's saying. And so Jesus gives them one more illustration so they'll understand exactly what he meant. Verses 36 and 37. He took a little child whom he placed among them, and taking the child in his arms, he said to them, whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me. And when he calls us to welcome little children, he's teaching us something really beautiful, that pure love is when you're willing to serve someone who really can give you nothing in return, but simply because you love them. You see, in the ancient world, it seemed that little children were seen as worthless. They're undeveloped adults, so they really don't have any rights, and generally people don't give them any attention. Seen as lower than widows in a male-dominated society, children were considered the ultimate example of weakness and dependence, but yet here Jesus is calling us to serve these worthless children because he's trying to teach us something about what it means to really be great in God's eyes. It means to serve that person in your life who really can't and isn't in a position to bless you in return simply because you love them. Jesus here is giving us the direction that all of us, especially me, need to take with exactly where we are in life, to not constantly be striving to go up and to the right and cling to as much as I can for myself, but in humility to be willing to go down and to the left, to serve people simply because I love them. There's a second principle that I see for today, that Jesus himself is headed in the right direction, in the wrong direction. And perhaps you could say that that's literal because he's on his way to Jerusalem to die for you and for me. But I say, if you pull back, that it's not just in this moment of his life, but that this was actually characteristic of all that he was all about. Philippians 2, 5 through 8, Paul, in speaking about Jesus, says this, have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. And here's the part that I really like. Who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself. And I find it so convicting that even being equal to God was not something that Jesus grasped, meaning he clung to it and he refused to let go. And the reason it speaks to me so much with everything that I'm going on in my own personal life is because it reminds me that we have a God who never said that he had already loved people too much. Not even if it meant giving up his wisdom. Not even if it meant giving up his authority. Not even if it meant giving up the glory that he deserved. None of that was too much. Because we have a God who not once in his earthly ministry ever said that he had already loved people too much. And look what happens next. He says he took the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. In being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. We have a God who never said that he had already done too much. Not even if it meant being trapped in a finite body where for the first time in eternity past, he just doesn't know things. He doesn't even know how to talk because he's trapped in the body of, in the mind of a baby. Not even if it means being trapped in a finite body. And so for the first time in eternity past, he's suddenly susceptible to sickness and he can get tired. Not even if it meant a God who never made a mistake, who never sinned. Now for the first time in eternity past, being accused of just terrible things and being betrayed by his closest friends. Because we have a God who not once in his entire earthly existence ever declared that he had already loved people too much. One thing that I'm learning about our God as I look into the scriptures is as powerful as he is, there are two things that God simply cannot do. As powerful as he is, God cannot lie. And number two, as powerful as our God is, he can never stop loving you. You know, maybe some of you remember this, but in 2017, about 4 years ago, that was when my mother, my late mother now, had her health had just taken a severe turn for the worse. And so maybe you recall, I had taken this emergency flight to Chicago to see my mother while she was still alive. But for reasons I don't really understand to this day, what happened was I come to LAX airport and I discover to my surprise that they had given me this free upgrade to first class. And again, I don't quite know why I was the one they gave it to. As far as I know, they didn't give it to anyone else. What I suspect was the week before, that was the week that Vietnamese doctor David Dao had gotten beaten and dragged off the United Airlines airplane. And so maybe they thought I looked like Dr. Dao. And maybe they thought, you know, this guy's Asian and we've had enough trouble with Asians. Let's just start giving him free stuff. But for reasons I don't know, they gave me, out of all the people on that plane, I was the only one to get this free upgrade to first class. Now, if you've ever ridden first class on an airplane, you know that it's really an experience. Like, the food is totally different. Even that painful tussle of getting onto the plane, and then the worst part is having to wait to get off the plane, it's a totally different story. It's an experience. Now, obviously, I wasn't the only one riding on that airplane that day, but maybe most of you can relate to this. What I recall was, even though I was the only one who got the free upgrade, not once did it cross my mind that I should refuse the upgrade and to give it away. Because the reality is the way most humans think in this world is they cling to privilege. They don't give it away. Isn't that so true? When we get promotions at work, when your salary is improved, it would be very strange if someone were to refuse it and try to give it away. You know, that guy's been waiting so much longer than I have for this promotion. Why don't you give it to him instead? You know, that lady, she's a mother and she's having a really hard time right now. She could use the money more than me. Why don't you give it to her instead? If that were to actually happen in real life, we would find it very strange. Because for most people in this world, they cling to their privilege. They don't give it away. And yet, when I see Jesus, it's so challenging because he comes to this world chasing these people who totally don't deserve it. He builds this team that no one building a company would want on their team. These people with these patterns of dishonesty, all kinds of character flaws, who have sinned in all these embarrassing ways. And so when I see that Jesus is declaring that he who must be first must be last and must learn to be the servant of all, what I see is that all the while Jesus was pointing to himself, because that's what his entire life was all about. And I see that Jesus is calling us, with everything that's going on in my life today, that this is the direction I need to take right now with where I am in life today. Well, the question is, why? Why does Jesus live like this? And why is he calling me to do the same? Well, it brings me to the third, perhaps the most important point for this morning's message. True love moves in the wrong direction. There's only one plausible explanation why Jesus would choose to make these choices with his life. It must have been because he truly did love us. I remember when Angie and I first brought Josh home as a one-year-old from Korea, how our total lives just completely changed, even more than when we got married. What we ate changed. Even when we went to sleep, that would change. What kind of people we hung out with, when our free time was. Our entire lives completely changed because now we had a little kid. I remember how I would read this one children's story, The Goodnight Gorilla. How I would read it over and over and over again to Josh, to the point where I could almost read it with my eyes closed because I had memorized every word on every page in that little children's book. And how even though I had literally read it hundreds, perhaps thousands of times, I would read it to him again to make him stop crying or just to make him smile. I remember when we first brought Josh home and he had this thing where he constantly had a runny nose. Maybe some of you remember that. He just always had a cold. He just had a runny nose and was coughing. And so what Angie and I did was we had discovered this contraption. It had this like suction ball on one end and the other end you would connect it to his nose and you would just squeeze the suction ball and it would just suck all the mucus out of his nose. What I remember is one time we were out and we had forgotten the suction cup, but Josh was just coughing and coughing and coughing. And he looked miserable as he just coughed and coughed and coughed. And I recall how I remember reading this article about how even though it's not perfect, our mouths can mimic the effect of those suction cups. And what could I do? He was miserable. He just kept coughing and he wouldn't stop. So I remember taking my mouth and putting it over his nose and sucking the boogers out of his nose into my mouth. And it was awful, right? It was absolutely disgusting because the taste I will never forget. But why? Why would anyone do things like that voluntarily? What any parent will tell you is the only reason we do these things is because of love. Mike Mason, the famous Christian author who talks about marriage, he writes about his own marriage this way. It's a little bit peculiar. He says, when he was getting married, he knew he would be insidiously, systematically destroyed. He was torn apart and disintegrated into ashes. Parts of himself, his rights, was now demolished. It's sort of an odd way to describe his marriage. But I think all of us who are married, we can relate to what he's saying. When you get married, everything changes. Your rights to privacy, your alone time, everything changes. But why do we do all that? We choose to do it because of love. 1 Corinthians 13:4-6, the famous love passage in describing what godly love looks like. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It seems that maybe one overarching characteristic of godly love is how other-centered it is, how it refuses to be self-centered. John 15:12-13 describes love as not just wisdom, not just as more noble, but actually as a command, as an act of obedience. This is my commandment, that you love one another. And here's the hard part, as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. And I ask myself, how do I know when I'm loving someone with a godly love? And I decided it's when I'm willing to lose so that they can win. How do I know when I'm really loving someone with a godly love? It's when I'm willing to serve them instead of demanding to be served. How do I know when I'm truly loving someone the way God wants me to love them? It's when I'm willing to forgive them instead of clinging to this record of their wrongs. You say that you love your family, but if you love your family, then make them the higher priority than your own. Be willing to lose so that they would win. Invest in them and serve them. We say that we want to love the people at work and we want to love the people in our schools this upcoming year of 2021. But if you really love them, then make them the higher priority than your own. Be willing to lose so that they would win. Serve them and invest in them. Hopefully all of us say that we love our church here at Harvest South Bay. But if you really love Harvest South Bay, then make Harvest the higher priority than your own. Invest in them. Serve the people here. Being willing to lose in your own life, not to be demanded to be treated equally, so that Harvest can win in the end. You know, I think to myself, what if people's hearts resist this kind of teaching when they think about the implications of what it really means to love people? Because when I look at what Jesus is saying here, he almost says it without condition, that this is just a declaration of what life is all about. Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all. And what if people say, you know, but I'm just not in that place in my life right now, and I've just got a lot going on, and that's not something that I'm able to do. Can I be clear? Self-love, self-care, it is a part of the Christian life. He's the vine, we're the branches. Unless you're connected to him, then it's impossible to love others. But here is a harsh truth that I'm learning in my own personal life. That sometimes in the name of self-love, we can very easily be pushed to the extreme where now I'm not really loving anyone except myself. What I'm learning about the Christian life in my own personal life is this. Is that when God commands us to do things, as hard as it is, it's always possible. It is possible because of him. Because here's the thing, if I'm always waiting for that person to be worthy of my love, for that person to change, for me to actually feel like loving them, then I might be waiting a really long time. But what I see in the scriptures is that love is in many ways like a roaring river. That as we pour out our love into someone else, just as an act of obedience, what he does is he pours into us and he makes himself the full supply. That in many ways, love is like this roaring river that as we press into others, God presses into us, even when we're still a work in progress. I may have shared this story before about Corrie Ten Boom, but I think it so perfectly captures what we're talking about here today. Corrie Ten Boom was, of course, a Holocaust survivor in Germany. She had actually been a prisoner, her and her sister, in a concentration camp in Ravensbrück. But apparently, because the conditions were just so brutal in those concentration camps, because the treatment was just so hostile, even though Corrie survived the concentration camp, to her great pain, her sister did not. Well, eventually the war ends and she's freed and she's not a prisoner anymore. And because Corrie Ten Boom was a believer, she was invited to give all these talks. And so she recalls there was this one evening she was talking about the grace of God, how deep it is, how it runs deeper still than any sin anyone could commit against us. That the grace of God is so deep that it can wash all our sins away. When to her horror, after she's done talking, she sees this old man slowly walking up the aisle towards her. And of course, she recognizes that this old man was one of the prisoner guards at the concentration camp in Ravensbrück. And he comes up to her and he holds out his hand to her and he says, you know, I really resonated when you talked about how deep the grace of God was. And you talked about that concentration camp in Ravensbrück, and I was the guard there. And what I want to know is, does God forgive me despite all the things I've done? And what I also want to know is, will you forgive me? And at that moment, Corrie Ten Boom said that this horror filled her heart as she saw this man that in many ways she wished that she would completely forget for the rest of her life. How she wanted to just run away as fast as she could and have nothing to do with him, because that was the very man that was apparently in charge of processing new prisoners, who would actually make sure that these female prisoners were stripped and would do all kinds of human atrocities to them. But as she looked at it, and she looked at this man who she felt no love for, she remembered how Jesus calls us to love our enemies. And so in an act of obedience, she forces herself to reach her hand out to his and embrace it in an act of friendship. And here's what she says happens next. For a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, the former guard and the former prisoner. I'd never known God's love so intensely as I did then. Here it is. But even so, I realized it was not my love. I tried and did not have the power. It was the power of God. And what I learned from this illustration is just that in many ways, the first step to loving people, even when you don't feel like it, is to act in obedience. Because can I say this? If we're always waiting for that person to be worthy of our love, if we're always waiting for that person to apologize and forgive us and actually change, if we're always waiting until we're in that place where we're ready to do that and we actually feel feelings for that other person, we might be waiting for a long time. And I know that this is a big statement, but I want to promise you this. That if you, in an act of obedience, even though you don't feel it in your heart, will at least attempt to love someone with the love of God, then I promise you that my God will take you to a higher place, and a better place, and a godlier place, and a more wonderful place than had you never attempted at all. And that's a promise I make to you. Who might God be directing you to direct his love towards with where you are in your life today? A family member, a friend, a coworker, a fellow student. Who might God be directing you to direct his love towards with where you are in your life today? Well, why don't we pray? Why don't we just bow our heads and spend a few moments in prayer as we close for today, this fine Sunday morning. I just wanted to invite you to spend some time in personal reflection and prayer. Think about not only what did Jesus mean when he said, he who must be first must be the very servant of all, that he who would be great must learn to be last. But more importantly, what does that say to where you are in your life today? And if this is convicting to you, won't you just pray a simple prayer? God, teach me to love. I want to love like you do. I want to follow in your steps. I want to move the way that you do. I want to stop clinging to what I deserve up and to the right, but I want to be willing to choose to go down and in. Teach me, God. I want to learn to love like you do. Would you just take a few moments to consider these things and to pray?
Falling from the clouds, a strangling sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. It's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. The music of the universe plays. Stars, where you are, and I'm so joyful and free. Song of galaxies reaching far beyond the Milky Way. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out. Let the music of the universe plays. Singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy. Still you love me forever, my stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy. Will you love me forever? My heart will sing of our grace, singing you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. Not so unworthy, but still you love me forever. My heart will sing of how great you are. There's an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring, and though the storms may come, I am holding on to the rock I claim. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? Can I keep from shouting your name? I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives, and I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me through, and sing the songs you care. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love. How can I keep from shouting your name? No, I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart wanna sing. I can sing in the troubled times, sing when I win, sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me run when I call to you in prayer. And sing with my last breath. Sing, for I know that I sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? I keep from shouting your name. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart know I am loved by the King, and it makes my wanna say.
So Lord, let us sing all the days of our lives, Lord, that you are our King, our Lord and Savior. Lord, we want to put you first in our lives and always, Lord. We thank you and pray all this in your name. Amen.
Well, good morning, Harvest. Here are a few important announcements for your attention. Thank you for coming and worshiping with us today. Number one is just, please take note on your calendars that just exactly 1 week from today will be our general membership meeting. It's once a year. We will hear what some preliminary plans are for this upcoming year, and also we'll see what the budget is. Number two, just please take note that next week's speaker will be Elder Danny Lee. And so here is a promo that he has put together.
Hi, honey. What are you doing?
I'm putting the finishing touches on my sermon for this Sunday.
What? You're preaching a sermon this Sunday?
I sure am.
But you've been in a happy mood all week.
I know.
But you're usually in a sour mood and all stressed before you preach a sermon.
That's true. But since I'm preaching on the topic of happiness and joy for this Sunday, I figure I better practice what I preach. And apparently, I guess it's working.
Looks like we can all benefit from more happiness and joy in our lives.
Absolutely. So I hope you will all tune in this Sunday as I preach on this very important topic, and I hope that you will all benefit from it. See you Sunday.
Okay, and number three, and finally, please take note that we do consider tithes and offering to be an expression of our worship here at Harvest South Bay. And so won't you just take a moment to prayerfully consider what is the amount that God has laid on your heart to help support us here. There's two options. One, you can mail your check-in to 4565 Sherian Lane in Torrance, Attention English Offering, and the church office will make sure it gets to the right place. And number two, we now have electronic online giving, and you can see the hyperlink at the bottom of this screen. Well, with that, won't you receive benediction, which is just a pastoral blessing over the church today. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the awesome power of our Father in heaven above, the ever-present fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with all God's people who are gathered here today. May we know the greatness of serving people even when they don't benefit us, because we know the purity, and we've done it out of the simplicity of love for you and love for them. And all God's people said, Amen. Go in peace.